إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. On this blessed day of Jummah, before one of our two big Eids, we celebrate one of our 52 Eids. Today, I'd like to talk about the concept of change. Specifically, when we look at the story of Musa alayhi salam and Bani Israel, that when Bani Israel, for their lives, were under the foot of Fir'aun, they were the slaves in that community. They were the people that were meant to build, you know, the lofty structures which we now, some people consider to be like, you know, one of the wonders of the world and miracles and things of that nature. And it was, you know, of these things that the Fir'aun, you know, became arrogant and thought that he was, you know, the Lord Most High. Na'udhu billah. But when Musa came, received revelation, and performed, you know, many of the miracles that he did, and led Bani Israel out from underneath the foot of Fir'aun into freedom, the amazing thing about this story is that the moment that they were in freedom, that they returned to their jahiliyyah. They acted on the same ignorance that they were brought up on, worshipping idols. They worshipped a golden calf. For the lifetime, and this is very ajib, for the lifetime of Musa and Harun, leading Bani Israel, trying to get into Jerusalem, they weren't able to get. They were in the desert for 20 some years, possibly more, searching, but they couldn't get it. And they were right there. But Allah didn't give them the opening. Because the people at that time were still acting as if they were still the slaves of Pharaoh. And it wasn't until their offspring that were born in freedom were able to actually enter the blessed city. They were born in freedom. They didn't have the mentality of slaves. They weren't serving another human being. They didn't have the bad residual habits that people whom were astray had. There were people that were born able to think about their Creator and to dream and to act without boundaries, because they serve the only true Creator. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them to get in. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that He will not change the condition of a people until those people first want to change their own condition from within themselves. And we're seeing, you know, change all over the world now. We have these snapshots from the Arab Spring, right, is what they call it. All of these countries in the Muslim lands that are coming from underneath, you know, these tyrannical rulers and these various people that were not letting their people live in freedom. We're seeing around this country various different, you know, Occupy, you know, movements. Occupy Wall Street, Occupy Oakland, Occupy this. We're seeing this. People are not happy with their condition and they're looking for change. So, in looking at these current events and thinking back on the story of Musa alayhi salam, I thought to myself, What is practical for us? How do we apply this concept of change? Not just in this moment, not just for today, not just for Eid, not just for maybe this week or this month or this year, but how do we make real change? And it starts first and foremost from within, each one of us, that we have to want it. If we don't want change, it's not going to happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in a hadith Qudsi, He says, "I am to my servant as he sees me." Right? So if we put limits on Allah's ability, that's what Allah is going to give us. Right? So if I get thirsty and I think, man, I'm so thirsty, and my thinking is, oh, I'll get like a Kool-Aid juice box. Allah will give me a Kool-Aid juice box. But He's not going to give me a whole pack of Kool-Aid. Right? He's not going to hook me up with, you know, an even better drink. He's not going to give me Zam Zam. He's not going to give me this or give me that. He's going to give me what I believe He's going to give me. And many times when we think of those things, He won't even necessarily give us that amount. He might give us something up to that, but not beyond it, definitely. So when it comes to our belief, the first and foremost is, if we believe that Allah is the all-powerful, if we believe that Allah is the provider, if we believe He's the giver, if we believe He's the merciful, right? Not just the merciful in a sense of like, oh yeah, He's got some mercy. The merciful. Like in reality, there is no one else, there is nothing else at all that has mercy except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing else that has provision that will give it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we believe that, then we won't put limitations on that. We won't put boundaries and barriers on that. And we'll see within the manifestation of our actions, of our speech, how we do things, and in the blessings that Allah gives us, that we get those kind of rewards. We get those kind of things. So when we talk about change, we have to start with ourselves. We have to start within our own hearts, and really wanting it. Not half-stepping, but really wanting it. But oftentimes, you know, maybe speaking for my own self, but I think also maybe, you know, at least for some in the Jama'ah today, I'm speaking as well for you on behalf of you, is that we often want to think of change for others before we think of ourselves. Especially those of us that are trying to practice some aspects of deen. You know, we get a little something under our belt, maybe we're making our prayers regularly, we fasted Ramadan a couple years in a row, right? Maybe we're giving zakah. Maybe we're going out, reading Quran a little bit here and there. Now all of a sudden we think that we're entitled to start looking at other people. To start pointing the finger at others. Right? And the whole thing isn't even about judging people. It's about being a mirror to one another. So if you're a mirror to me, or if I'm a mirror to you, when I get up in the morning and I look in the mirror, I don't want to see something ugly. Right? I mean, unfortunately maybe I do every day. But I don't want to see something ugly. I want to see something handsome, something beautiful. So when we're trying to be a reminder to one another, why are we doing it in a way oftentimes it's ugly, that puts a bitter taste in our brother or sister's mouth, that puts a frown on their face instead of a smile, that doesn't make them feel warm. It makes them feel cold. It doesn't bring them closer to Allah, it pushes them away from Allah. And we think we're doing something good. Well, at least I enjoy good and forbid evil. But you are actually, possibly, the very reason that maybe pushed that person away. And then it goes back to the idea of wanting to initially look at others before we look at ourselves. And that was the one thing that I can say as a theme. From the very beginning, when I started studying Islam and really learning something about it, that the Prophet and his companions, their nature was they were hard on themselves and they were soft on others. They would beat themselves up. We know all the stories. Prophet would stay up all night long praying. Companions would do the same thing. Right? They would give of their finances. They'd reach into their own pockets and give out of their own generosity. But they weren't running around beating on other people. At the same token, they were like a tight-knit family. So if I came to one of you, or you came to one of me, one of you came to me, then it wouldn't be a problem. Brother Harun, I'm sorry brother, but you know, I noticed a little something like, you know, you've been off a little bit. I noticed that you did something like this. You know, inshallah, Allah doesn't really like that, so switch that up. Thank you brother, jazakallah khair, good. That's how their community was. To the point where, and we oftentimes we interpret this story the wrong way. There was a woman at the time of the Prophet that committed adultery. Right? And no one knew about it. It was a secret. And she went to the Prophet because she feared Allah. And she knew that Allah witnessed and saw and knew that act. And she went to him. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, I committed zina. I don't want to face Allah on the Day of Judgment and be punished for it. So give me the punishment of this life that I have to have. So that I can have that expiation. And in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ turned away from her. Like he didn't want to hear the story. Giving her a chance. And she persisted, Rasulullah, I did this. I want to be forgiven. I don't want to have any doubt on the Day of Judgment. Because that day is true. There's no doubt about it. I don't want to face Allah on that day and have that something that I still got to answer for. Please, just give me what I have coming to me. 2 to 3 times he pushed away. And when she persisted, he said, fine. Go and have whatever Allah is going to give you from this and then come back to me. And what he meant was, you're going to get pregnant from this, you're going to have a baby, nurse the baby and have that 2 years and then come back to me. So again, he's giving her a long period of time to just make repentance and to just walk away from the scenario. She did all of that and came back to him and persisted. And then when the companions were fulfilling the law for that, that some of her blood got on one of their pieces of clothing, and one of the companion that got on his clothing was like said some nasty things in regard to her, and the Prophet scalded him. And I forget exactly what he said, but it was along the lines of like the fact that this woman, watch what you say, because the iman, the faith of this woman is very high. So have fear of Allah yourself. And sometimes I think the best of my deeds isn't even worth the blood that was on that clothing of that companion. So we have to think really about change. Really about what it means to us. Really about our own, salvation. Really about our own guidance. Then when it comes to the aspect in talking about family, we talk about that a lot. The idea of parents, and children, how we interact. And the parents, we look at our kids and we want to get on them because they're not doing the right things. But honestly, what kind of example are we giving these kids? Right? We go and see our son or daughter, carrying themselves in a certain kind of way, talking a certain kind of way, dressing a certain kind of way, acting a certain kind of way. But are the people that we're hanging out, does my son or daughter, do they see me hanging out with Lil Wayne? Posted up, talking about some jahiliyyah? What kind of example am I? Do they see me with their own eyes doing things that contradict the very things I'm telling them to do and not to do? So why should they listen to me then? Why should they even trust a word that comes from my mouth then? And when it comes to the children, that oftentimes, and I can tell you from my own experience in life, that my father and I, when I was a young man, especially when I became a teenager, may Allah have mercy on the teens that's in our Jaman, those of us that have teenagers, may Allah have mercy on us and them. I mean, that when I was a teen, when I became a teen, I butted heads with my father. I had a lot of anger inside me towards him. And I didn't understand why, but I just did. Because as a young man, that was a time that I needed him in my life the most. But he was working hard to provide for the family. And I didn't understand that. I was being selfish. All I saw was my dad doesn't spend time with me, he's a jerk. And so because of that, I went out of my way to be harsh towards him. But when I became, a bit more mature, when I got married, when I started having children of my own, I started realizing how really hard it is to be responsible. How really difficult it is to be a good father and a good husband and a good provider. And at the same time, still be a good man. Still have my own relationship with Allah and have all of that all at the same time. When I started realizing and understanding how hard that was, that's when I started feeling the real guilt about how I treated my mother and father. Because I didn't understand. And they say ignorance is bliss. It is. Because when you know and you understand the weight of your actions is something, sometimes it is unbearable. And that's the right that our parents have on us. I was listening to a discussion a few days back, and And this one brother, he was a poet. And he said in a couple of verses, you know, that something to the along the lines of saying that the burden and the hardship upon a mother and father is that even though our children are the only things truly for many of us in our hearts that we give amongst other human beings unconditional love, that our children are the very sources of heartbreak that we face more than anything in our lives. So as parents, we have that dubious distinction and honor and weight that we have on our necks, that our children have our hearts the way that they do. And as children, it's responsible for us to understand that we have that ability in the way that we are towards our parents. And we should honor that and be delicate with that. And we should be soft with them. And we should be respectful and understanding. This is what we really are talking about practically about change. This is where it really comes from. And if we have that kind of respect going back and forth, that as parents we first lead by example, that we don't ask our children to be and do things that we're not ready to do ourselves, and as children that we respect and honor our parents for the sacrifice that they give, that they make, then that change is something that is going to be something that you can't even put into words, that you can't even describe. It would be, in its rawest, purest sense, a feeling that you can't talk about. And that, when it comes to this type of concept, that's the Islam of that subject. That's the beauty, the light of that subject. And then we get into some of the more, you know, general aspects of change. When we talk about the change of individually, establishing our prayers. You know, one of the things that the Sheikh talked about, I'm not sure if it was last week or the week prior, but he talked about the idea of, you know, the salah being the thing that separates iman from kufr. And that's something that honestly, brothers and sisters, we should not take lightly. You know, and maybe it's redundant that I'm saying this to those of us in the community that are here praying, the importance that we need to make prayer. It sounds redundant, but maybe it will touch your hearts that maybe you'll go to one of your relatives. Maybe you'll go to your mom or dad that doesn't make salah. Maybe you'll go to your brothers, your sisters. Maybe you'll go to your friends and you'll talk to them and you'll share this with them. So it still has that impact, that reminder, it benefits the believer. And even though, and for those of us that are here, that alhamdulillah are making our salawat, but maybe we're missing one. Maybe we have a situation where we think, oh, I've got work, I can't pray Dhuhr Asr. I've got class, I've got to miss this. I've got to do that. I can't make my salah. Remember where our priorities need to be. And it takes 2 minutes, 3 minutes. You know? I knew a brother to talk about what the length that they went to at this, briefly, that he used to do door-to-door sales. And he was on his job once, and came time for Asr, and you know, the window was like now, where the window of time is very short between prayers, you know. So he was, you know, trying to hit all the houses he needed to hit, and he had to make Asr, and he couldn't find a place quiet where he could make Salah. So he prayed like on a street corner. He just roughed it, right? He prayed his Asr on a street corner. And so this woman across the street came out of her house and started trying to talk to him, right? And she was like, praise the Lord, brother, are you okay? What's going on with you? You all right? You hurt? His brother's, you know, just trying to do his thing. And so, like, he finished his prayer and had actually a very healthy conversation. And, you know, it was something interesting, you know. Don't have the time to go into details. But the point is, he recognized something he had to do. And he knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saw him. He could have easily just been like, you know what, you know, the Muslim brothers I know, they don't see me at the masjid right now, my mom and dad or anybody else, they can't see me. I'll just pray later, no problem. I'll make it up at home. Or, you know, malish, you know, Allah ghafur rahim, right? But he didn't do that. And that's the point, is showing up is half of the challenge. Wanting to be there, wanting to take on this responsibility of Islam is half of the challenge that we have to at least face it. And none of us are perfect. But showing up has a beauty to it. That you come sincerely with an open heart, and Allah will bless you with much. So we have to make these changes. We have to want these changes within ourselves, and we have to try to start making the efforts to make these changes. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me, to forgive us all, and to guide us to Jannah. Ameen. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulihim Kareem, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allah will not change the condition of a people until they first want to change the condition within their own selves. We often want to debate about what's wrong in the Muslim world, what's wrong with the Ummah, what's wrong with humanity. It starts with what's right inside of us. We have to answer that ourselves. Instead of asking that to everybody else, instead of trying to make presumptions about it, about why it's somebody else's fault, we need to start taking responsibility for our own share of the blame. And we need to start making a change. Tomorrow is a good opportunity for us. We have Yom Al-Arafah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of our brothers and sisters around the world that are making the Hajj and give them tawfiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from them their Hajj, to overlook their shortcomings and to grant from them and to give to them, you know, the most of what they can get from their Hajj and from their Arafah. Ameen. As for us that are not there, and may Allah bless us inshallah next year to be there together, that we have Yom Al-Arafah, that it's an opportunity for us to fast and to increase in our worship. And the reward that is given for that is that if we fast on Yom Al-Arafah, that our sins for this current year and the year to come are forgiven for fasting this day. So it's important that we try to do that if you have the ability to, with your time, with your health, you know, if you've committed some sins, you know, if you've done some things that you regret, and you're worried that maybe in, you know, tomorrow or next year you're going to do some things that maybe you're going to regret, it's a good opportunity to get that stuff wiped off the slate. So, inshallah, let's try to fast and to increase in our ibadah. If we're used to making our prayers, you know, and we don't do the sunnahs, maybe try to do the sunnahs. You know, if we're not used to doing salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, maybe do the salawat on the Prophet. If we're not used to making istighfar, increase the istighfar. Increase the tahmid, right? Saying alhamdulillah. One of the things that the companions, a few of the companions even went to the point of doing in, I think it was Ibn Umar, radiallahu anhu, that like during this time, he used to go in the marketplace, which is a place where most people are buying and selling, and like the last thing on their mind is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He used to go through the marketplace chanting very loudly, subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Right? So it's important for us, you know, to take on these things. And dhikr is an easy thing. If we're driving, if we're working, we can do these things. It's not like we're at a gym and we have to, you know, lift too much weight, you know? So inshallah, we have the ability to do that. And then also, as a last reminder, remember that we have Eid inshallah Sunday, and that we're going to have two prayers here. We'll have one at 9 a.m. and we'll have one at 11 a.m. I believe, right? So 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. we're going to have the prayer here at the masjid, okay? So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us our good deeds. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our sins. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to overlook from us any of our shortcomings, any things that we have done that are not to His liking, that could bring shame to us, to bring shame to our deen, to bring shame to our families. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put light in front of us, to put light behind us, to put light to our right, and to put light to our left, and to put light above us. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put light on our tongues, and light in our eyes, and light in our ears, and light in our hands, and light in our feet. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us whatever we have done of good, and to forgive us for whatever shortcomings we have committed. Iqam as-salam.